Good evening, everybody. It's again our pleasure to welcome you all to this series of webinars on spintronics, what we call as W2S, because webinar series on spintronics 2020. And we are really grateful. So far, it is very overwhelming response from the participants. Nowadays, of course, the number is less, but still, it is quite international, I would say. People from different countries are joining, and this gives us the energy to continue. And today, we have Dr. Sanjay Singh as the speaker. He is working now as an assistant professor in School of Material Science and Technology at IIT BHU in Varanasi. He did his PhD from UGC BA CSR Indore in 2012. Then he was at several places for his postdoctoral work. For instance, at the Photon Factory in KK, Japan, SIMP in Kolkata. He was an Alexander von Humboldt Fellow in University of Duisburg, Essen, Germany, where I did my PhD.
Oh.
We have something in common, Sanjay. And he was also working at Max Planck Institute for Chemical Physics of Solids at Dresden, I think with Professor Claudia Felser, who is a known name in the field of spintronics, in particularly for Hoster alloys. Okay, Professor Claudia Felser works on everything in principle. So, he joined IIT BHU in 2016. His work is mainly based on the designing and designing and understanding and understanding metallic alloys for various technological applications like magnetic refrigeration, spintronics, thermoelectrics, magnetic self-memory alloys, and so on. And I think today he's going to talk about these Heusler-based compounds for spintronics purposes. And he has published more than 50 papers in very high quality journals like NatureCom, PRL, PRB, APL, PNS, etc. He has been recognized with several awards and recognitions such as the Inspire Faculty Award, the Humboldt Fellowship, Ramanujan Fellowship, and the Young Scientist Medal by Indian National Science Academy, that is INSA. So with this short introduction, I'd like to formally welcome Dr. Sanjay Singh and thank him on behalf of the organizing committee. So my co-convener, Dr. Brajbhushan Singh, is sitting next to me. And we are thankful to everyone. And we are looking forward to your lecture, Sanjay. So please.
Thank you, Dr. Vedanta, for introduction. And thanks a lot to you and organizing committee to invite me for this webinar. This is a nice series of webinar. And especially I heard some webinars, a few of them, and it's very useful for new students. So thanks a lot. So today I'm going to present some of my work on atomic ordering and magnetic structure of Heusler-based spintronics material. So here is the plan of my talk. So I plan in two parts. The first part is basically basics of diffraction and about X-ray versus neutron, what are the advantages of neutron and what are the advantages of X-ray, something like that. And then how we can know the atomic and magnetic ordering. And then the next part is basically about the spintronics Heusler materials and how we can use the neutron diffraction to understand the atomic ordering and different kinds of magnetic structure, which are useful for spintronics currently and in future. So I have chosen the three examples here shown. So let's start with some basics. So if I ask a question that how to determine the crystal structure at atomic ordering in a material, the immediate answer comes the X-ray diffraction. And why X-ray diffraction? The answer is because it has a right wavelength which can diffract with the material. And this equation, which is well known, we all know this Bragg's law, n lambda is equal to 2d sine theta. Okay, so if you see the Einstein and Planck, they gave the theory that the light can be also, light have also the energy and momenta. And in 1925, the de Broglie gave a very important theory that since a moving piece of matter has momentum, So it might have wavelength also, that is known as de Broglie, the dual property of wave and matter. So if we compare the different kinds of massive particle with their energy and wavelength, then we can see that there are different particles which have similar wavelength, which are useful for materials characterization or interatomic distances. If you see the neutron, this line falls here. So the energy of neutron in eV and the wavelength in angstrom here. So this tells us that not only X-ray, we can use neutron also, and even electron diffraction are also well known. And some places the helium atoms are also used. So here we will basically talk about neutron. So its wavelength is comparable to the interatomic distance, so we can do the diffraction. So this is the well-known Bragg's law. So you have the wave entering into your material. So you have atom, and then wave is reflecting back, and then these are the planes, and from different planes, the wave reflected will finally get interference, and we have the diffraction pattern if this condition is followed, where the n lambda is your path difference. So this is a fundamental thing. Now let's see some of the materials. So it's example of cubic crystal. So here we have two examples. One is NaCl, which has FCC structure, and other is CaCl, which has BCC. So this crystal has unit cell as well as they have atoms inside the unit cell. So these are the position of NaCl inside the unit cell, and these are the position of Cs and Cl. So the question is how to understand the position of the atom, that is called atomic ordering. So now, if we have FCC crystal structure, so we have these four position of atom. So from our fundamental physics book, we understand that we can calculate the structure factor for different HKL planes, and we can say that which reflection will occur or which will not occur. So for example, for FCC, we all know that if HKL are odd, all odd or even, then we see the reflection, and if they are mixed, then we do not have any reflection. Similarly, we can give the basic example of BCC material. So here in case, if we calculate the structure factor, so you see, if you have this kind of reflection, means if all are H plus K plus L is even, then we have some reflection intensity. If they are odd, H plus K plus L is odd, then we do not have any, so we do not have intensity, means no reflection we can see. Okay, so we can, if you see the list, then we have different kinds of HKL planes list for different kinds of materials. So based on these planes, we understand the atomic ordering. Okay, now if we call about recall about diffraction method, especially for students, that we can do two kinds of diffraction method. Either we can use single crystal, where you have incident beam and the crystal is reoriented in different angle with respect to incident beam, and we have the diffracted beam in case of if condition is satisfied, the Bragg diffraction condition. On the other hand, we can do the powder diffraction. So the powder diffraction, we basically compose of many single crystalline samples, and if we find, if the incident beam find a particular this small tiny crystals which have orientation proper for the X-ray for the diffraction condition, then we see the diffracted beam and we see the HKL intensity. So if we compare these two, then in the single crystal method, we can directly see the 3D picture, means we can straightforwardly observe the crystal symmetry and it's very clean method. In the powder, we see this, this is example of 1D powder diffraction pattern. So you have multiple peaks, and we have to do many things to understand the crystal structure. So basically here I will discuss the neutron powder diffraction. So let's see the powder diffraction. So in powder diffraction, all the three dimension information is basically condensed into one dimension, like here. Then we may have peaks overlap, and then different kinds of complicated calculation we have to do, different types of analysis, Liebel, Rietveld, all you might have heard. And the phase information is lost basically, and crystal symmetry you cannot directly see. You have to do many analysis, after many analysis method, you get the crystal symmetry and other information. Then the basic question is coming, that why people generally use the powder diffraction instead of single crystal diffraction. So the answer, if we see that, the first thing is that it's really difficult to get good quality of single crystal. It's not simple to grow the single crystal. And in some cases, for some of the material, even single crystal do not exist. Okay, and then you have twinning and phase transition problems. So if you go for the powder diffraction, we have reasonably good information. Basically for high symmetry crystal, suppose if you have a cubic crystal or tetragonal, then you can easily analyze the data and get all the information related to your solids or crystals. And it's easy and fast technique, we all know. Just we prepare sample and go to our lab and put the powder and get the diffraction and analyze. So in every institute or in every lab, people are used to for this kind of experiment. Now, if you see any powder diffraction pattern, this is suppose one dimension powder diffraction pattern I have shown, then if we analyze the peak position, then we can get different kinds of information like crystal systems, space group symmetry, translational symmetry, unit cell dimension, and you can do also, we can do also qualitative phase analysis, identification basically. Then if we look for the peak intensity, then we can say where my atoms are. Basically we can do quantitative phase fraction analysis, and we can also tell about texturing effect or preferred orientation. And if we analyze the peak shape, then we can say about crystallized size or strain or stress. All these information we can get from a simple one dimension powder diffraction pattern. Okay, now the next question comes, which radiation we should use. So if we see, the X-ray is most common technique, almost available in all institute, in every department, basically physics and chemistry oriented departments. Then the question is, why we think about neutrons? Okay, so here is the answer. So neutrons, if we compare with the X-ray, so neutrons do not have charge, so they can penetrate very deep into your material, so you can have bulk information. In fact, many physics problems were solved by neutron, like there are many systems where the charge density wave was initially observed from X-ray and but not from neutron. Then it came out that this in some of the systems it is a surface effect. Okay, then if the wavelength is of course compared to interatomic distance, so we can get the structure, and energy also is comparable to atomic vibration what we have, so we can study the dynamics of the solid. Then another important point is that it has random scattering amplitude across the periodic table. I will discuss how it is useful and the location of, so because of this we can have the location of light elements in the presence of heavy ones. Basically if you want to, we all know that the X-ray scattering length or X-ray form factor, atomic form factor, it depends on the atomic number. Okay, so as you increase the atomic number, the form factor increases, and if you decrease for light elements, for like carbon and all, it's very less. So it's almost impossible to know the position of very light elements within the crystal unit cell. Okay, the other important thing is the magnetic moment. So neutron had magnetic moment, so you can understand the magnetic structure of the material, which is very very important thing if we are working in the spintronic material. Okay, so for the discovery of the neutrons, means that from the neutrons where the atoms are and what they do, basically the dynamics and the structure, this Nobel Prize was given in 1994 for the students specifically. Okay, so now it comes come about the neutron scattering length and X-ray scattering length. So as I mentioned earlier, that if you keep on increasing your Z atomic number, the X-ray scattering length increases. Okay, on the other hand, for neutrons it's a dramatical behavior. Okay, for some of the atoms, like here this red color, it's negative also, and it doesn't go as per the atomic number. So it's easy to know where are the atoms inside the unit cell if they are very close. For example, if you have iron and manganese, so you see from X-ray the scattering length is same, so the structure factor will not affect if you change the manganese and iron position, so you will not able to understand where your atoms are. But if you use neutrons, it's clearly visible. Okay, so here for example I give you the KCl, okay, potassium chloride. So here the potassium chloride have almost same number of electrons and not differentiated by X-ray. You see the X-ray pattern, diffraction pattern, okay? And if you use the neutron, then you see here you had no intensity, but suddenly you have higher intensity. So it's easy to analyze and detect where are my atoms. Okay. Then next, so this is important for atomic coordinating. Other thing is the magnetic scattering. So we know this neutron has spin, so it may interact with the electron spin, and we can have the information about magnetism of the solids or magnetic structure of the solid. So there are two things here. If you compare with the X-ray, the neutron or nuclear form factor, okay, which is due to the interaction of neutron with the nucleus, is almost constant with the angle. Okay, so that's why you see at higher angle also you observe high intensity peaks from the neutron, but not from the X-ray, because it fall down with respect to theta. Okay, on the other hand, the magnetic form factor and the magnetism is due to the interaction of neutron with the outer shell of unpaired electron. So that's why it follows this like X-ray form factor, and it goes down with as you increase the theta. Okay. So coming to the magnetic structure for students, basically. So if you have a paramagnetic structure or the system is the parametric space, then you do not have resultant spin. So basically your Jij is zero. Okay, so you don't see any effect of magnetism. On the other hand, if you have an antiferromagnetic system, okay, like this, then you see some Jij, which is positive, and total energy is negative. Okay, now let's come to the crystal and magnetic structure. What are the relation, basically, how we determine? Suppose if you have a ferromagnetic material, okay, then all spins are aligned in the same direction. So this green, this unit cell is crystallographic unit cell, okay? And these are the spins on each atom. Now, if you see all over your system, these spins are arranged in a one direction. So what? If this is your crystallographic unit cell, you can repeat this and generate your three-dimensional solid. And same time, the spins also follow the periodicity of lattice. So you have this kind of structure of ferromagnetic, so you don't get extra reflection. On the other hand, suppose you have antiferromagnetic material, you see here. So spins are arranged in this plane upward and in this plane downward, and then again upward. So what happened? This was your crystallographic unit cell, but magnetic unit cell is now doubled, okay? So where it, the magnetic periodicity comes? So here and here. So it's two times of crystallographic unit cell. So what happened if you do a neutron diffraction measurement, then you see something like this. So if it is a ferromagnetic material, you have some intensity contribution in the same reflection. So basically these are crystallographic reflection. And if it is ferromagnetic, then you see this dark region. So you have ferromagnetic contribution. On the other hand, if you have antiferromagnetic material, you see completely new peaks are arising because your periodicity has been changed, or you something like a supercell you have. So you have extra peak. So this is a simple example. You can understand if your material is antiferromagnetic with different unit cell as compared to the crystallographic unit cell. Okay. So now with this basic, I come to the system, the Hussler alloy. So Hussler alloy are basically very important alloy, and it was basically first discovered in 1903, and Friedrich Hussler discovered that Cu2M and Al, where all atoms are non-magnetic, but the resultant system is ferromagnetic. Okay, so if you see the structure, if you compare the structure, there are two kinds of initially known Hussler, but at present there are many kinds of other Hussler alloy has been considered. But initially it was half Hussler, where you have this cubic structure and your octahedral voids are filled, and tetrahedral voids are half filled. Basically, you have 8 tetrahedral voids, but only 4 are filled. So it is half Hussler. Now, if your octahedral and tetrahedral both voids are completely filled, then you have full Hussler kind of thing. And these are the symmetric element. Okay. So if you see the Hussler compounds using this structure, these compounds have created a great interest in recent years, basically because they show variety of properties, starting from magnetocaloric shape memory to spintronics and many more. Here some of them are listed. Okay, and these all properties depends on structure and chemical elements. So if you easily, you can vary easily by changing this XYZ chemical structure. This is example of nickel to manganese gallium, which is almost most studied system in this these Hussler compounds. So you see, this is a cubic, then you have tetragonal, then this side you have inverse tetragonal, so variety of structure. Okay, so now I selected here for today's talk, I selected three composition, where one is Mn2nIga. So here I will discuss, so this was the first kind of a natural spin valve, I will discuss more, and then this Pt2MnGa, which is basically newly prepared system, and it is important for antiferromagnetic spintronics, and then Mn3Ga, which is very known, well-known antiferromagnet, which is gives large anomalous Hall effect. Okay, so this I show some results with pressure. So let's come to the first result. So basic is the spin valve. So in all spintronics field, people know about the spin valve. So basically, you have asymmetric. The signature of spin valve is asymmetric magnetization. So if you apply positive field, then you see one resistance high or low, and in other case, it's opposite. Okay, and it depends basically the spin valve structure. You have one fixed magnetic layer, and other is free layer. Okay, so when you change the magnetic field, this free layer align in the direction of the field, and depending on the layer arrangement with the fixed layer, you have higher or low resistance. So basically you can switch the resistance, and this is useful in the memory devices. But this effect is observed only in the thin film heterostructure, where you can design multi-layer. So one layer is fixed, and then you have non-magnetic layer and for as a separation, and then you have again a free magnetic layer. Okay, but what we observed something like a spin valve in Mn2nIga. So Mn2nIga, if you see, this is important system, as it shows large magnetic field in this strain, but I'm not going into that detail. But the mainly thing is that it's ferrimagnetic system with high magnetic ordering temperature around 573 K, and it gives phase transition from cubic to tetragonal structure. In the tetragonal, it has I4 by triple M symmetry, so it's centrosymmetric system, although there is another controversy, which I'm not going into that detail about the symmetry, but the final symmetry observed from neutron diffraction is I4 by triple M, and these are the atomic position. So here I use manganese subscript nickel with respect to Ni2MnG, because Ni2MnG is standard Hussler system. Okay, so now if we measure the magnetoresistance of Mn2nIga, and we saw something interesting near to the zero magnetic field. If we apply the positive field, the resistance is high, and if we go for the negative field, the resistance is low. So almost asymmetric magnetoresistance we observed in this system, which is a bulk system. Okay, and we repeated this measurement in single crystal also, and we got the same asymmetric magnetoresistance in polycrystal and in single. So the black are for polycrystal and red for single crystal. Okay, so this was unusual for us, because generally this behavior is observed in the thin film heterostructure. So to understand this effect, we did the neutron diffraction pattern, because first our aim is to understand what is the crystal structure or atomic ordering basically. So we did the neutron diffraction pattern, and this is the typical neutron diffraction pattern. But as I discussed earlier, that neutron has two advantages. One, in this system we have manganese, nickel, which have almost similar, where they are very close. So Z is similar, so X-ray is not able to detect or differentiate between manganese and nickel position. So that's why neutrons are very good, because manganese gives negative scattering. Thus, then to understand, as I told, that the TC or magnetic ordering temperature is around 573. So we are at room temperature, we are at the magnetic state. So then the question is how we can get the crystal structure, okay, if you are in the magnetic regime. So the answer lies here. So as you see, the magnetic form factor goes down as you increase the theta. So generally, if you're for a wavelength of 1.59 angstrom, generally above the 2 theta equal to 60 degree, the magnetic contributions are negligible. So we started with the analyzing the data above 60 degree, 2 theta equal to 60 degree. Okay, and we did the refinement and we saw that if we don't take disorder, any disorder, anti-site disorder, then the fitting is almost good, but you have one peak here, the 314 HKL values are, it is not fitting properly. Okay, there is a clear difference between observed, this red one, and the calculated peak profile, the black one. So then we started considering disorder, and if you see, if you take the manganese and gallium, means the manganese which has original position, this 2A in the Hussler, and the gallium which has 0.5, then we don't see any improvement. But finally, we saw that the chi-square is reduced and fitting is very well. If we consider the disorder between manganese at nickel position and this gallium, okay? So these are the atomic position, but finally, I show you here something. So this is the final fit, which is very good with chi-square on 0.2. So this is the unit cell, okay? So you have basically a ferrimagnetic lattice, okay? Now, here this gallium is going to the manganese position and manganese is coming to the gallium position. And the interaction between this manganese, the original manganese, and disorder manganese is ferromagnetic. On the other hand, the interaction between the original manganese and manganese, which is at the manganese nickel position, is ferrimagnetic, okay? So the things are, the situation comes like that you have a ferrimagnetic lattice, okay? And due to disorder, you have some ferromagnetic, soft ferromagnetic region. So now the situation, I have plotted a cartoon here, basically. So you have a ferrimagnetic lattice, which is rigid. Now, because of disorder, you have some ferromagnetic clusters, which are soft to rotate. So when you change the magnetic field direction from positive to negative, these ferromagnetic cluster rotates and gives some torque at the interface of this ferrimagnetic lattice, and you have this two different resistance situation which was observed here. So basically, due to the special kind of magnetic structure or due to the atomic ordering, disorder in the atomic ordering, you get this ferromagnetic free kind of layer, and one is ferrimagnetic, which is fixed layer, and that's why we get the this asymmetric magnetoresistance behavior, which was not, which is generally not observed in the bulk system. It is only in the thin film heterostructure. So this was the about the spin valve effect in MN2 and AJ. Now I come to the another example of antiferromagnetic spintronics. So nowadays, antiferromagnetic spintronics has gained a lot of interest. Okay, initially it was considered that it's difficult to detect or manipulate the antiferromagnets, but now there are many ways to detect. Okay, the advantage of antiferromagnets are, of course, there are no stray fields, so the information is error-free, and also the dynamics are much faster than the ferromagnet. And there is a lot of papers have recently reported, and there is an electrical switching of antiferromagnet has been also reported in 2016. So now, for this antiferromagnet, we went to the literature and found that this is an interesting system. Okay, if you see the literature, very old literature in 1971, so this reports that PT2MNGA is an antiferromagnet but cubic. Okay, and if we see recent theoretical papers, then they say that this system must be tetragonal and ferromagnetic. Okay, and then another theoretical paper, it's from our group actually, that if we increase the platinum in place of nickel in Ni2MNGA, the standard system, then you have increased antiferromagnetic interaction. So there are many controversies. So either it's cubic or tetragonal, or it's antiferromagnetic or ferromagnetic. Then we prepared this system and did the X-ray diffraction measurement first, and we found it's clearly tetragonal at room temperature. So first thing is solve that it's not cubic with TN75, it's tetragonal. The next thing, we went for the magnetic measurement, and we find that the this is antiferromagnetic system with higher CN around 350 Kelvin. So here this is ZFCFC curve, low field magnetization and high field, and you see very low moment. Okay, and then when you do the MH curve, it's completely linear, and we have also checked with high field measurement. We went up to 60 Tesla, but it's almost antiferromagnetic behavior. Okay, even at very low temperature, we have some component of ferromagnet, but basically it's antiferromagnet. Okay, so then the next question was, what is the structure, the magnetic structure? Okay, so to answer that, we did the neutron diffraction measurement. Okay, so first we did the measurement at high temperature, means in the paramagnetic phase, to get the correct atomic ordering, and we applied the same trick which we did for Mn2 IgA. And the advantage of neutron, of course, that we can detect where are atoms, and we finally found that it has also some amount of disorder between manganese and gallium. Yeah, this is the profile. But now the interesting thing is that when we went below the magnetic transition, we see the extra peaks. So as I discussed in the beginning of this talk, that if you see extra peaks, means the system is going to the antiferromagnetic phase, and which we also sign them MH curve. And if we find the K vector, as in my example, I took that unit cell is just double. So the K vector was 2 times. But here the K is 0.388, means in the C direction, the unit cell has been increased, the magnetic unit cell. And after the analysis of this, we find very nice non-collinear magnetic structure of PT2 MNGA. The interesting thing of this system is that the most of the non-collinear magnetic structure reported in literatures belongs to non-centrosymmetric system. But this is a centrosymmetric system, and with this very nice spiral magnetic structure. Okay, and the beauty of structure is that once you have a centrosymmetric system, okay, then what we propose, that if you perturb the system with external magnetic field, then what you can do, suppose this is your propagation director pointing upward to the in this plane, then if you apply magnetic field, then these spins can change their direction and your helicity can be changed. So depending on the helicity, because both have similar ground state, you can have two state of helicity, and we propose the new system at room temperature antiferromagnetic tetragonal Husler, which can be used as a helicity based random access memory. So basically Q is your propagation vector and K is your helicity vector. So once you apply the magnetic field, external magnetic field, then you can change the helicity of this material. You see, if you follow just this spins, now it's changed. So the helicity is basically EI cross EJ, means how neighboring spins are changing. So from one helicity to other, here helicity is basically parallel to the propagation vector, and here this is perpendicular to the propagation vector. So one can design the helicity based random access memory based on this system. So after this, now coming to my last system, which is basically we studied the origin of interesting Hall effect change with pressure. So as I have seen in many in this series, W2S webinar series, people have discussed already with this Hall effect. But a small introduction for the students who have joined just today, not heard earlier talk, that of course in your basic physics or in MSc physics, you have heard about Hall effect. So Hall effect is, if you have current in one direction and magnetic field in perpendicular direction, then you have Hall voltage generated in the third perpendicular direction. And it's scaled with the magnetic field like this. Okay, so this is a standard Hall effect which is observed in non-magnetic system. But recently, this anomalous Hall effect has gained more interest, where the Hall scale, the Hall resistivity also has contribution due to the magnetization. So this is called the anomalous Hall effect. And if you see the normal Hall effect, it goes linearly, but here you see large like a magnetization loop. So this is the anomalous Hall effect, just for the definition. And the interesting thing is that, so if you see this equation, so if you have large magnetization, then you have large anomalous Hall resistivity or anomalous Hall effect. So if M is zero, then you must you should be able to measure zero anomalous Hall. So means for anti-ferromagnet, it must be zero. But what has been observed in some Mg3X based Hussler compound, these are known as nowadays people call hexagonal Hussler compounds. So these hexagonal magnets, that you have large anomalous Hall effect. And if you go to the origin is related with the electronic structure of these materials, which is called the Berry phase in the momentum space. But I will not go into much detail on that because my aim is to show you something different with the neutron diffraction. So, but this system is important because of unusual anomalous Hall effect. Okay, fine. So if we see this result, okay. So if you apply the pressure, okay, then what you see, if you follow this 0.05 means almost ambient pressure. And if you keep on increasing pressure, the Hall resistance or Hall conductivity goes to zero and then change their sign, its sign. Okay. For almost it's, you see, this is a 2.3 GPA. And then this highest one is for 2.85 GPA. So it changes their sign. So our aim to understand what is happening with pressure. Okay. Because this here, the Hall is also related with your very nice magnetic structure, the 120 degree triangular magnetic structure. Okay. So we prepared this one and tried to do the pressure dependent neutron diffraction measurement. So you see, this is at 410K. This red one is in the paramagnetic phase and 90K in the magnetic phase antiferromagnetic. So you see, you have change in the intensity of reflection. So it's still it's antiferromagnet, but propagation vector is zero. Means the crystallographic unit cell and magnetic unit cell are similar. Okay, but the arrangement is this triangular antiferromagnet. So we did the pressure dependent neutron diffraction. If we follow these peaks, so you see here, as you increase the pressure, this 101 peak is decreasing, and with respect to this, you can see the 200 peak is increasing, and you also have 201. So we tried it. So one thing is important to mention, that if you are doing the pressure dependent diffraction, it's difficult to do the refinement proper and get the information. So the easiest way to just model theoretically the diffraction pattern. So that's what we did here. And if you see in the standard, this if you put the theta between different angle is 90, you get this diffraction pattern. If you change the theta, there you see here, you don't see any 200, which is nuclear, but of course the relative intensity you can compare. And you see, as you change the angle in your theoretical model, you start seeing this 200 peak compared to the 1001. And what is happening here? So on the basis of this theoretical model and our experimental pressure dependent neutron diffraction, we propose that as you apply the pressure, the spins acquire a uniform out of plane canting, and that's what we get this change in the sign of anomalous Hall. So finally, I will conclude with this, that the powder neutron diffraction is a very powerful tool to understand. And not only I should say that it's not only to understand, but we can predict new material for future spintronic devices. And finally, I would like to show, this is my small research group with whom I'm working. Mostly they are PhD students here and one postdoc. And we have some facilities, like we can prepare this arc, the intermetallic systems here. And basically we work on the on very high vacuum to make the very very pure systems, and we can do the temperature dependent XRD to analyze the structure initially, and we can go both high and low temperature. Then for magnetic characterization, we have PPMS. Recently we got this rotator also, so we can do heat capacity and magnetic measurement in single crystal, and even in the we have got ETO options, so we can do transport. And here this is a 7 Tesla magnet, where my students recently made because of their hard work, we can now do magnetoresistance and Hall measurement together with the dielectric, magnetodielectric measurement. And we have this some different kinds of facility, which is dynamical mechanical analyzer. So for magnetic pupil physics department, so like as we have a spin glass, we may also have a stained glass if you have local atomic defect in the structure. So finally, I would like to thanks, and questions are welcome.
Okay, Sanjay, thank you so much. So we clap for your excellent talk.
Thank you very much. So I'm on the time or?
Yeah, you are absolutely well ahead of time.
Okay, thank you.
So no problem. We can take a lot of questions. So where is the chat window? So Mainu Rehman, he is asking, sir, is this thin film or bulk? If it is thin film, then what is the thickness? And if it is bulk, then can share the synthesis procedure?
All these samples are bulk. And the synthesis procedure I showed, this is the arc melting sample. So we take the raw materials, different, like if you want to make XYZ, so XYZ, you weighing in proper ratio and put it here, take do the vacuum, and with arc you can melt them and then do further annealing in the vacuum. And exact temperature and all you can find in the papers. I think I have mentioned these references also. So annealing temperature and all, if you want. These are bulk.
Yeah. So does that answer, Mainu Rehman? Mainu, or you have some more questions?
Yes, sir. Thank you. But I have some more question. So last in Mn3G. So can you go to Newton diffraction slide? Yeah, here. So what is this angle theta equal to 90 degree and theta equal to 45 degree? And
this is angle between these spins. So initially it is like that. Okay. So 120 degree it's like. So now you have to vary the angle between these spins and then generate the theoretical pattern. So that's what we did. Here you see it's almost zero. They are aligned complete perpendicular. And then you have some 45 degree angle and then 90 degrees. So angle between these spins.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Anyone else has questions? Well, maybe people are thinking. I can ask one or two questions. So what is this dimension of these single crystals of the various materials, whatever you are synthesizing? How large are they?
These samples.
Or in one go, how much you can prepare, you know?
Okay. So so we have here this. So we can prepare. So these are polycrystals all, okay? Except this data. This was on the single crystal. Okay. So we basically mostly prepare polycrystal. Now we are going to get a new single crystal preparation machine. Then we'll start the single crystal preparation. So if you see here, we can grow up to around almost 15 to 20, 15, I think 15 centimeter, 1 to 15, 10 mm to 15 mm dia. And I think we can go more than that also in the circular shape. And then we can cut in the required shape if you want.
So we are wondering if you can make it 25.
25. I can check. Actually, I am getting now new this arc melter. So there I think it's possible to make bigger one. It's nothing, because here if you see, you have a copper hearth. If you make it bigger, so it's just we can go to our workshop and ask them to make bigger dia, and then we can melt the sample. So that's not a big issue actually.
Okay. And in this manganese germanium, so what are the open questions actually right now?
Okay, in this manganese germanium, the open questions, if I see, is still one question is remaining, that this, I have not discussed that part, but one thing if you see here, okay? So if you see that with pressure, you have large hysteresis. So hysteresis is also increasing with pressure, okay? So in the this powder form, we observed that some part of tetragonal phase is also present. Okay. So whether the tetragonal phase is having some effect on this observed behavior of MN3GA, that is still not clear.
Okay. So we want to study with the different kind of phases.
Yeah. So right now we are looking for the local. So we are using this local probe, the pair distribution function, to understand if there is something locally you have this tetragonal phase. So I have not presented here, but with pressure, if you go with this paper, we have shown that as you increase the pressure, then you have tetragonal phase. But from there, this phase is coming. It must be locally already present there. So that's what we are looking for. This is the one thing.
And in the initial part, when you were talking about this this kind of crystal compounds, so platinum and other materials, so I think these are the materials where you can potentially see the skirmions, isn't it?
Yeah, if skirmions, I cannot guarantee. Okay, because now people are basically, if you take a material and it is non-central symmetric and anything is there, you can sell as a skirmion. Okay, and if you take central symmetric, then you have to give a lot of reason to the referee. We have this Ni2MnGa on which we are working. I am working from my PhD. So here also you see skirmions. Okay, but this is a centrosymmetric material. Okay, but there are a lot of debate. So, but one needs to basically answer. I cannot say this PT2MNGA. If I say it has non-collinear, but we have not seen skirmion, particularly in this sample.
Yeah, but did you observe any topological Hall effect on that?
I have not measured yet. I have not
measured. You have not measured.
Because just now we have got this our instrument ready, so now in future we'll get. And also the other answer is, whatever we are doing on the bulk, okay. But as soon as you go for the thin film, then things are completely different. So there is a possibility for sure.
Now, thin film is one, but also on the bulk. So I'm sure you will try to do the topological Hall effect to see if there is a potential material, isn't it?
Yeah, we can see, but basically I think in thin film will be better because these are centrosymmetric system. So
okay, there is a student from my group, Ajar. So you want to ask Ajar or should I ask?
You can ask.
Oh, you can ask. No problem.
What changes that single trace cell makes in the spin ball devices that I have
just a moment. Your voice is little bit noise. So Vankar, can you repeat the question? Because your voice is clear.
I think your voice is not clear. I will ask. So he's asking what changes in the single crystal will make this spin ball device.
Which device?
I mean, role of single crystal in the spin valve devices performance, sir.
Ah, spin valve devices.
Yes.
So here, as I showed this, the disorder is basically making. So for the spin valves, what you need some fixed magnetic layer, and one is free layer. Okay. So the same thing is happening because of disorder here. So you have a ferrimagnetic. The whole matrix. The system is fixed like a hard magnetic layer. And then you have, because of disorder, you have soft ferromagnetic cluster, which you can easily switch from one direction to others. Like here, they are pointing upward. Here, they are pointing downward.
Okay? Yes, sir.
So that's what we are proposed, that this is a typical related with the system. It doesn't require polycrystal or single crystal. Okay. Oh, so this is a disorder system.
Okay. What about then conductivity mismatch, this kind of problem, spin polarization, sir? In this system?
Spin polarization measurement, I don't think someone has done.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. So are there any other questions? So I do not see the case. So then I think we can thank Professor Sanjay Singh for his very nice lecture. An excellent way he has given the overview of various aspects and introduced these concepts. So we are grateful, and hopefully I will see you guys next week in our next webinar by Professor Kubota. It will be also on Hoistro Alloys,
okay,
I believe, from Tohoku University in Japan. So he's mostly working on thin films, so on GMR.
Mm-hmm.
And their group has achieved the highest micro distance, I think. So, please stay safe, stay healthy, and see you next week. Take care. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.